Welcome back to OZK 150. Today we're going to be talking about early European and European American settlement in the Ozarks. And we're going to be talking about the French who got here first. We'll be talking about the Anglo-Americans. We'll talk about some German settlement in the years before the Civil War. And we'll get specific with some of those, and we'll talk about how they got here, where they came from, and all that kind of stuff. Before we do, though, we will talk a little bit about our famous Ozarker. All right. If anybody's miserable in the wintertime and you're waiting for baseball to roll around or something to indicate spring is here, here's your picture. Anybody know who this famous Ozarker is? You can see their honorary category, which means he's actually not from the Ozarks, but he has some kind of connection to the Ozarks. Any clue who this is? This is really obscure. This is going back a few years too, as you can tell from the photograph there. Does anybody know what uniform that is? The A's. It was the Athletics, the A's. And I don't, that's either going to be the Philadelphia A's or the Kansas City A's, probably the Philadelphia A's, before they made their way to the West Coast, to Oakland. You know, they had a little stopover in Kansas City before the Royals started up, and then they made their way out west. But this is a guy who was known in his playing days as Ozark Ike. His name was Gus Zernial. You can see he passed away just a couple of years ago. And Gus, not a terribly memorable baseball player. Most of you probably never heard of him. But where he gets his name is from the comic book down here in the corner in the 1950s, beginning in the late 40s and into the 1950s, there was a comic book by the name of Ozark Ike. That was the title character, and he was an athletic guy. He was a boxer sometimes and a baseball player, but he was supposed to be from the Ozarks, kind of a big country galoot sort of guy. And Ozark Ike, the baseball player, being this big, strapping, kind of country strong-looking guy, got the nickname Ozark Ike because people thought he looked like, or at least, you know, it was kind of shaped like or something, the comic book guy. So Gus Zernial, who was not from the Ozarks at all, he's from Texas, as a matter of fact, got the nickname Ozark Ike, and he is our honorary famous Ozarker of the day. So,
how long was that comic book?
I don't know how long it was in operation. Not very many years. You can still get them off of eBay and stuff like that. And there was also an Ozark Ike comic strip. The comic strip lasted longer than I believe the series of comic books did, but they're collector's items today. It's one of many comic books from that era that had the curvaceous women in them, and I think that's one of the reasons that they're collector's items today. You know, if you've ever been to a comic book convention, you know, you might see guys who'd be interested in curvy women in comic books. I don't know. I've never been to a comic book convention, so I'm talking about something I don't know anything about. But Ray Gatto was the artist's name. Okay, so that's our famous Ozarker. Our vocabulary phrase for the day is let own. And in the Ozarks, it's own, it's not on. So what does it mean to let own? Okay. It's actually, it's kind of a two-part thing, but that's one of them, to acknowledge or to admit. And the other one would be to pretend. If you let own, you pretend. So you got it. Millie got that one, to let own.
I heard people talk like that.
Well, I hope so. Yeah, that's rendered in authentic fashion. This So just a couple of examples, both to pretend and to acknowledge.
What's the name? What's the person's name?
Lige. What would that be short for?
Elijah.
Yeah. There used to be lots of Liges in the Ozarks, in the South. But you don't see many of them anymore. Or you could say Elijah, but it's usually Lige.
And what's sparking?
Sparking? Yeah. Courting? Yeah. Yeah. No, it's not a misprint. It's not a typo. Yeah, that sparking is dating or courting or something like that. So, all right. Lots of stuff you learn. It's vocabulary class, basically. You think in Gainesville, there's still some people saying sparking or?
Yeah. Well, not sparking, but let on.
Yeah, let on. Yeah. Yeah, you'll hear it. Yeah. Okay. Our early settlement. As I mentioned, we will start off talking about the French who settled the Mississippi River Valley and sort of ease into the edges of the Ozarks in the 1700s. We'll actually go back before the 1750s for a little bit. And after that, we'll get into Anglo-American settlement, and then we'll end with German settlement. We oftentimes in our U.S. history classes forget to mention the French, but the French started settling what we know as Canada just right after the first English settlers came to Jamestown and made their way up the St. Lawrence. They actually plowed into the western part of North America much more quickly than did the English. We know that for generations, the English basically stayed pretty confined to a narrow strip along the East Coast. The French made their way into the Great Lakes region. By the latter half of the 1600s, they were already exploring the Mississippi River Valley. We talked earlier about the French setting up Arkansas Post in the 1680s as one of their first, really the first permanent French outpost in the Mississippi River Valley. Well, in the area that we're talking about today, in the area close to the Ozarks, the first French outpost or settlement is just across the Mississippi River, Kaskaskia, Illinois. It's still there today, still it's very small and hard to get to nowadays, but it's still there. It was settled right before the beginning of the 18th century, and it would be really another 50 years or so before the French set up a permanent town, a permanent settlement, west of the Mississippi in Missouri. They, for years and years, kept their center of operations on the Illinois side, and then they would explore into Missouri. They would explore the Ozarks, the Missouri River Valley, all over west of the Mississippi from their base in Kaskaskia. And they also began mining in the early 1700s. It's probable that there were French explorers who came into what we know as the Ozarks before 1719, but we know the earliest that we have on record is Claude Charles de Tesnay, who came into the Ozarks in the year 1719. He was a Frenchman who worked for the Company of the West, which was a company that basically had control over the Mississippi River Valley. The King of France had given this company the control to spark immigration and to start farming and mining and all this kind of stuff. And he left Kaskaskia, came across the Mississippi River, headed into the interior of the Ozarks traveled across what we would consider the northern Ozarks today, Washington County, into Phelps County, Pulaski County, came all the way over to the Osage River in Miller County, and went back down the Osage River, which is actually going north to the Missouri River. He covered a couple hundred miles in the Ozarks in 1719. Didn't leave that much record of what he saw, but we know that that he and his party made their way through the northern part of the Ozarks, the first European that we for sure know of. And it was right after that that the French got involved in lead mining. One of the things that attracted them to the Ozarks, or at least what the northeastern part of the Ozarks in those days, was all these lead deposits that they found. And many of them were on the surface or very close to the surface, and they were easy to mine, they were easy to get a hold of, and they could always use lead. What do you think they used lead for? Bullets, mainly for ammunition. There were lots of other things you can use lead for as well, but the French were hunters and trappers and things like that, so they were always in need of lead for shot. And they began mining in the 1720s, first led by Philippe Renault, and later by Cadillac. Cadillac was actually the one on the ground doing most of the work. Renault owned a couple of the mines that they started in the 1720s. And these two early mining settlements, and now again, the reason we don't call these permanent settlements is because mining was a seasonal activity. They didn't stay in these little mining settlements year-round, and so there was really no permanency to them. The French miners, and a lot of times slaves, would come to Mine Lamotte or old mines during season. They would work and then go back to Kaskaskia, or later go back to St. Genevieve when they weren't mining. But here is Mine Lamotte, modern-day Madison County, Missouri. If you know where Fredericktown is, it's not too far north of Fredericktown, just a few miles north of there. And Old Mines is in Washington County, north of Potosi. If you don't know where Potosi is, you've probably heard of Potosi, Missouri. We'll talk about Potosi quite a bit today. And both of these were French lead mining settlements that were occupied off and on for many, many years. And eventually they would both become permanent French settlements later in the 1700s, but not in those earliest days. They were just mining outposts. The first permanent settlement in the vicinity of the Ozarks was the town of St. Genevieve. And if you go to St. Genevieve today, you'll immediately recognize what the town is about. They're all about their French heritage. They've got lots. We'll see some pictures of some of the old French houses that have survived from the 1700s and early 1800s there. And it's a neat place. It's not a place that is particularly Ozarky. It's one of those places on the fringe of the region. If you go over there to St. Genevieve today and talk about the Ozarks, they'll look at you like you're crazy because they're not in the Ozarks. Culturally, historically, not an Ozark place, even though it's on the fringe of the region as far as geographers are concerned. Remember our earlier discussions about how to define the region, all that stuff. But we talk about it here because it's important. St. Genevieve, for years and years, becomes the base from which the French travel into the Ozarks, trade with the Indians, especially the Osage living in the Ozarks. They mine from there. St. Genevieve becomes the great shipping point for all the lead that's mined. A lot of these early lead mines at Mine Lamotte and Old Mines and some of the other French mines, Remember, this is the 1700s we're talking about. Even today, it's not a terribly quick trip from Old Mines or Mine Lamont to St. Genevieve, and you can imagine what it was like in the 1700s and early 1800s, and what they would do in a lot of cases to get the lead to St. Genevieve, which they could then ship down to New Orleans on the Mississippi River, was they would cast the lead in the form of horse collars or in shapes that they could place on a horse or maybe on oxen and carry the lead to St. Genevieve that way. And then people could melt it back down and do whatever they wanted to when they got it to wherever they were going to sell it. But St. Genevieve became the great shipping point for all of this lead that was mined in the interior of the Ozarks, for the salt that was mined. There were lots of salt mines in the northeastern part of the Ozarks as well. Salt was another essential product, and you had a lot of salt mining in the region. But here is St. Genevieve. It's just a couple miles off of the river today. Originally, it was built in the floodplain. The old town of St. Genevieve was actually built in the floodplain of the Mississippi, and it was destroyed, mostly destroyed by a flood later in the late 1700s, and then was moved onto higher ground a couple miles inland from the river, and that's where the town is today. So when you go to St. Gen today, it's not the original St. Gen, it's a couple miles away from the original place, but it's not going to flood like the old one did. So that becomes a very important place in Missouri history, in the history of the whole Louisiana country west of the Mississippi River. It's a little bitty place today, but it's older than St. Louis and was for many years a very important town. And certainly when it comes to the Ozarks, it was a very important place because it was the center of economic activity for the Ozarks. Yeah, how high was it? How high was the water?
It was the highest one. It was well over 10 feet.
Yeah. Yeah. It's still close to the Mississippi River.
Oh, yeah. It's right there. They have baseball fields just 100 yards from
the river. Right. Right. St. Genevieve is still not on really high ground. It's higher ground than it was back in the 1700s, but, I mean, it's still close enough to flood. Is that right? The entire floodplain was, I guess, flooded at that time. Yeah.
Because you can drive back over the railroad tracks that run right along the river, and it says, like, welcome to Missouri. As soon as, like, you turn around and start, like, looking back into St. Genevieve, there's a welcome to Missouri sign, but the ferry dock was flooded.
Yeah. Yeah, and when you go to St. Jen today, as I mentioned, you're probably not going to think, the first thing that comes to mind is probably not the beautiful Ozarks. You know, it's on the edge of where the land starts to get a little bit higher, but it's got its own history and it's a separate history, but it's a useful history for us, and that's kind of where Ozark history, at least this phase of Ozark's history, starts, is with the founding of St. Genevieve and the founding of these old French mines, the French influence of those early days, and. As the latter part of the 1700s wore on, there were additional French settlements that were established in the interior of the Ozarks. The last of those was established right around 1799, 1800, right at the end of the century, and it was St. Michael. And St. Michael was founded just a few miles south of Mine Lamont, and it would eventually become the town of Fredericktown. So St. Michael is part of Fredericktown today. And it was the last of the French villages that were settled before the Anglo-Americans came in and just completely flooded the region and took over everything. A few houses that you'll find today. St. Jen claims to have more of the pre-1800 French houses than any other place in America today. And I guess that's right. There are lots of them over there. You can see that, again, these look different than what we usually think of as old-timey Ozarks houses. What do we usually think of? Log cabins. We'll see log cabins after a while. But these are not your typical log cabins. The French did not have that log cabin building tradition. They did use logs. You had to use something over here. But one of the things they did that was different than the Anglo settlers would do and the German settlers, they often would drive their logs. They would use vertical log construction instead of horizontal log construction. When we talk about later in the semester, when we talk about the log houses being built, you know, they would lay the logs horizontally, one on top of another, and they would, you know, fix the edges and all that kind of stuff. Well, the French a lot of times would just drive the logs vertically into the ground and build their houses that way. What happens to those logs that are stuck in the ground? They rot. That's right. They eventually rot. So it's a wonder that we've got as many houses that have been preserved in St. Jean as we do, because the foundations would rot on those. So a lot of the logs, I'm sure, were replaced over the years. The French used an old world model for building their villages like St. Genevieve and like St. Michael in the Ozarks. And this was a very different way of settlement than the later Anglo-American settlers would have. The French generally set up actual villages. And their villages were made up of these little blocks, square blocks. And the villagers actually lived in the village. When we get to the Anglo-Americans, we know that they tended to live on scattered farmsteads away from other families, sometimes miles away from the nearest family. The French villages were not set up that way. They had neighbors. They lived in town, what passed for a town. Most of them were farmers, however, and they would go out during the day and they would work their individual pieces of land. There was a common field that the entire village shared, but each family or each farmer had a strip of that field that belonged to them or to him, and they would work their individual strip, grow whatever it was that they were growing, barley, wheat, oats, and then in the evening they would come back to the village, come back home, and then each one of their settlements had a common grazing area, a park or a commons, and this was usually a woodland where they let their animals roam out, cattle, sheep, whatever they would, hogs would roam out in these areas. We have to remember that back in these days, they practiced open range herding, just like the Anglo-American settlers would. This continued in some remote places in the Missouri Ozarks into the 1960s, but certainly it was prevalent all through the 1800s and well into the 1900s. In most places in the Ozarks, not just the French areas, but the way this worked was, under the open range, you let your animals run out, wild or whatever you want to call it, and you actually fence in your crops. Today we fence in our animals, but back in those days you fenced in anything you didn't want the animals to eat. So your garden plots, your common garden area or crop area, and everything else was fair game for the animals. They could roam around town, they could roam around out in the commons, the park area. Hogs did very well in this system. Hogs could eat acorns and all kinds of other stuff. They can survive very well, and hogs will become feral very quickly if left out like that. Places in the Ozarks today still have problems with feral hogs. They're not wild hogs. Hogs are not indigenous to the Americas, so we don't call them wild hogs. They're feral hogs. They're tame hogs that have become wild, have become feral hogs. The Razorbacks, that's where Arkansas gets its mascot. The hogs that, when they live out in the woods like that and they live off the land, they even change their look and they start to look kind of like the Razorbacks. And so this was practiced by farmers, by rural people from the 1700s well into the 1900s around the Ozarks and around the continent for that matter. Cows were kept out as well. Of course, we know that cattle were branded. Hogs were marked with some sort of mark in their ear usually. Each farmer would have his own mark, and other farmers in the community would usually know the mark of every other farmer. So if you saw a hog running out wild, you could identify whose it was. The same with a cow and a brand. All right, so that's a little bit about French settlement. The French period lasts for a few generations in the Ozarks. Certainly throughout most of the 1700s, you have the French either mining and having these little mining settlements for part of the year, or having a permanent settlement in St. Genevieve, and later in the late 1700s, some other permanent settlements farther into the Ozarks in places that we would consider the Ozarks today. So it's the French period lasts for quite a while, but there are never very many French who come to the region. You're talking about just a few hundred people who come here. And
what about Cape Girardeau?
Cape Girardeau was founded in the later part of the 1700s as a French town, and Cape Girardeau quickly gets taken over by the Americans beginning in the mid 1790s, and within just a few years it has become, despite the name Cape Girardeau, which is obviously French, it becomes very much an American town where Anglo settlers outnumber the French. But it's another one of those settlements that was French. But the French have, even though they don't come in large numbers, they're quickly outnumbered by the Anglo settlers within just a few years. They leave their mark on the Ozarks in the naming of physical characteristics, especially the closer you get to the Mississippi River, the more likely you are to come across hills or creeks or rivers with French names, or towns with French names. And it's the same with parts of the Missouri River Valley as well, because like most early settlers anywhere, they tended to stay pretty close to the major river valleys. So we have quite a bit of French influence in that way, and there are people, there, especially in the northeastern part of the Ozarks today, who are descended from the French, but the French don't have near the influence that the Anglo settlers would have, who flood in the 1800s and become sort of this little neat story in Ozarks history, but they're not the main story in Ozarks history. Something to give the region and its history a bit of diversity, but their story is quickly drowned out by the thousands of Anglo settlers who come in. So here, of course, when we're talking about Anglo-American settlers, we are talking about settlers primarily of English descent who are coming from east of the Mississippi River. Now remember, we talked a little bit earlier about the French having control of this area west of the Mississippi River up through the French and Indian War. At the end of the French and Indian War, the French, who lose the war to the British, lose control of their land in the interior of North America, this place they call Louisiana. They lose control of it, and it ends up in the hands of Spain. Now, you might wonder why we don't have a Spanish section here. And that's because very few Spaniards ever come to Missouri, ever come to the Mississippi River Valley. For the most part, the Spanish, even though they control this area for a couple of generations in the latter part of the 1700s, they let the French, who were already living there and had been living there for generations, run the show. And a lot of times, even the local officials will be the same French officials who were running the show before the French and Indian War. So the Spanish are technically in control, and they have final say over immigration policy and laws and all that kind of stuff, but very few of them ever come to Missouri, to Arkansas, to the Ozarks, to the Mississippi River Valley. So it remains very much a French area under Spanish control. And then we know that in the early 1800s, in 1803, the United States, during the presidency of Thomas Jefferson, makes the deal with France, whereby we buy the Louisiana Purchase from France. France quickly gets it back from Spain just in time to sell it to the United States, and it becomes official in 1804, and we get the voyage of Lewis and Clark. They come in and explore the Louisiana Purchase to find out just what it is we bought, you know, kicking the tires after buying the product here. Turns out it was a pretty good buy, pretty good deal. But even before we get to the early 1800s, English-speaking Americans had started coming across the Mississippi River and settling this area before the Louisiana Purchase was made. And in some places, like Cape Girardeau, by the time the Louisiana Purchase was made, they already outnumbered the French. And there were several hundred American families living in the Ozarks by the time the Louisiana Purchase comes about. So Anglo stands for English. These are not all people descended from the English, but they're English, for the most part, they're English-speaking U.S. citizens that we're talking about here who flood into the Ozarks beginning in the mid-1790s and certainly continuing up until the Civil War and then starting again after the Civil War is over. So we'll talk a little bit about who these people were, what their ethnic and national backgrounds were, because they were, as I mentioned, they weren't all people of English descent. As a matter of fact, probably most of them were not of English descent, but they mostly were British descent. We'll talk a little bit about where they came from back east of here. Most of the settlers, so-called Anglo-American settlers of the Ozarks, beginning in the late 18th century, continuing through the 19th century, came from a specific area back east that we call the Upland South or Appalachia. You've heard of the Appalachian Mountains. Doesn't mean they were all from the mountains, but they were all from that greater upland area, the Appalachian Mountains and plateaus around it and river valleys in it. And most of them came from there or through there at some point before they got to the Ozarks. Now, obviously, when you're talking about English-speaking settlers up and down the East Coast, if they're going to make it over here to Missouri and Arkansas, where the Ozarks is, they're going to have to cross this at some point. And many of them live in that Upland South area for a while before they come here. Why would a place like the Ozarks attract settlers from the Appalachians, from the upland south.
River system down in New Orleans for trade would be easier than trying to take it all the way across Virginia or that area to try to, you know, get their goods out to England or somewhere else.
Well, it could have something to do with the Mississippi River and trade patterns and all that kind of stuff. Okay, the terrain is similar. The land looks familiar to them. That has a lot to do with it as well. If you've ever been to, Middle or East Tennessee, Southwest Virginia, Western North Carolina, some of you have probably been to places out there, and you know that the terrain is very similar. The weather patterns are going to be similar. And today, the regional cultures are very similar. People talk much the same way. Our Ozarks vocabulary phrases that we learn in here, all of them pretty much can be found back in Appalachia as well. And a lot of that is because so many people in the Ozarks have heritage back in that region. There are close connections between the two regions. Now, that doesn't mean that everybody who made their way to the Ozarks came off a mountaintop in East Tennessee or in Eastern Kentucky. They didn't all come from the Smokies or the Alleghenies or something like that. But many of them did, and many of them brought those traditions and that kind of cultural heritage with them as they came to the Ozarks, and that included dialect, religious practices, the way you build log houses, the way you farm, all that kind of stuff, hunting, and we'll talk about all that as we go through the semester. But these areas, what you get, what we'll see in a minute is that Tennessee and Kentucky especially, and depending on where you are in the Ozarks, sometimes Virginia, supply especially large numbers of the settlers who come to the region. We'll talk about some specific instances, specific families that come over. But when we talk about the upland south and not talking about the Ozarks, this is pretty much what we're talking about. And this was the great feeder area for those early Ozark settlers. Now, we know in American history that this Western manifest destiny type settlement tends to happen in more or less parallel lines. We know that if you start up in New England, New Englanders tended to migrate across the northern part of the United States in parallel lines, across into upstate New York, into northern Ohio, northern Indiana, into Michigan, Wisconsin, places like that. And it stands to reason that the people who would end up living here in the Ozarks would come from right across here. And you can kind of see that the dots bear us out as we come across. So Virginia, North Carolina, Kentucky, Tennessee, those become the feeder states for most of the people in the Ozarks. Now, there are always exceptions to that, and we'll talk about one particular family that migrates to the Ozarks from Ohio. They don't stay very long, but most of them come from here. There was a study, we talked last time about the Cottaway Hills of southeastern Missouri, very rugged area, Reynolds County, Shannon County, Carter County, sparsely populated, rugged area. People go there to float today. There's not a, you know, floating and the timber industry, not a whole lot else going on in the Cottaway Hills. But there was a study done using census records from 1850 to try to find out where the settlers were coming from and settling in that region of southeast Missouri. And this study showed that fully two-thirds of all the adults living in that area of southeast Missouri, right in here, in 1850 were born in either Tennessee or Kentucky. And there have been studies of the Arkansas Ozarks that have shown that Tennessee overwhelmingly supplied the settlers who came there. Of course, those settlers probably had parents who were born in the Carolinas or Virginia, because Tennessee hadn't been settled for just a whole long time by the time settlers started coming to the Ozarks. This map is a map that looks at each one of these little white dots corresponds with a black dot. So what this map maker has done is started in the Ozarks with people that they were able to find out where they came from back east of the Mississippi, and there aren't lines. It would be a complete mess if you tried to put a line to each one. But again, each one of these white dots corresponds with one of these, and that's where they've come from. So you can see, especially here, since so many are clustered in southwest Missouri and northwest Arkansas, Tennessee heavily provided these settlers. But you can see that they've come from all over the place as well, dots here and there. But again, as we talked about, many of these settlers had developed a strategy for surviving. They had developed a way of life that fit East Tennessee or Southwest Virginia or Eastern Kentucky or Middle Tennessee. That way of life often revolved around open range herding, raising hogs and cattle and letting them range out in the hills and periodically rounding them up, killing a few of them, maybe selling a few of them, growing just enough crops to make what you needed to make to survive. And this was a lifestyle. It was a strategy that fit relatively rugged areas that were hilly, that weren't as fertile as other areas and river bottoms, and say in northern Missouri and southern Arkansas, places that had better dirt, better land. And when they went looking for new places to settle, they often found places that looked like they had come from and where they could recreate their lifestyle. So you may wonder, if you drive into Douglas County today, you may wonder, why would anybody in the 1800s settle in Douglas County, Missouri? You know, it's rough, it's rocky. There's practically no crop growing that goes on there today besides hay and pasture and stuff, and people's gardens and stuff like that. But if you come from a place that's similar and you've already developed this lifestyle that fits a rugged, hard-to-live place, then it makes sense. You may not want to settle in a nice flat area in West Tennessee somewhere, or you may not want to go to Mississippi, even though it's much more fertile. It's your style. Now, we've already talked about the so-called Anglo-American settlers. The vast majority of them were of British descent. That can mean they were of English descent. It can mean they were of Welsh descent, and some of them were. It could mean that they were of Scots-Irish descent, and many of them were. The Scots-Irish may have probably made up the largest single group of settlers to the Ozarks in those early days. And when we talk about the Scots-Irish, who are we talking about? What were the Scots-Irish? Does anybody know? They were from Ireland.
And Scotland.
And Scotland. There you go, Butch. You've traced them back. The Scots-Irish is a name that Americans, especially historians, give to a specific group. These were settlers who came in droves. Well, a little bit before that, yeah. Yeah, those are mainly the Catholic Irish, and a lot of Protestant Irish who come later on, the potato famine Irish. But these are settlers who start coming in the early 1700s, continue to flood into the United States up to the time of the Revolution and then continue after the once the Revolution is over. They come from Northern Ireland, what's known as Ulster, the counties of Ulster. And if you go back about 100 years before they start coming to America, many of their ancestors had been settled in Northern Ireland from Scotland or from Northern England or from Wales. And this all goes back to religious persecution and the attempts of the English to subdue the Catholic, the so-called wild Irish, the Catholic Irish. And in the early 1600s, the idea was, okay, we can take a lot of these Protestants from southern Scotland, from northern England, from other places, and we can settle them in Ireland and sort of start pushing the Irish out. We can just sort of remake this plantation, as they called it, this Irish plantation using Protestants, many of them Presbyterians, other Calvinists. And so that's what happened. They started settling them in Northern Ireland, and Northern Ireland becomes primarily a Protestant place on what had been a Catholic island. And then by the early 1700s, because of economic problems and sometimes famine, sometimes, you know, religious issues, political issues, these Northern Irish, these Protestants from Northern Ireland, the Ulstermen or the Scots-Irish as we refer to them, came across the Atlantic Ocean by the thousands. There were tens of thousands who came, many of them originally settling in Pennsylvania, making their way down into Virginia and the Carolinas. And many of these Scots-Irish were the ancestors of the settlers who came to the Ozarks in the early 1800s. And again, they were Anglo-Americans. By the time they get to the Ozarks, most of them, except for the very earliest ones in the very early 1800s, most of them were thoroughly Americanized, and most of them didn't think of themselves as Irish anymore by the time they got to the Ozarks, especially if they got here in the 1840s or 50s and their families had been in America for 100 years. They had been Americanized, but they still had a lot of the traits of their Scots-Irish forebears. Moonshine making, fiddle music, a lot of the traits that we still associate with the Ozarks today. But these were the so-called Scots-Irish. Back in the East, in places like the Carolina Piedmont and the Valley of Virginia, those Scots-Irish in the 1700s and early 1800s were often living in the vicinity of another group of immigrants who had come from Europe to America in the 1700s, Germans. There were tens of thousands of Germans, mainly Protestant Germans, who came over again in those same years, in the 50 years before the American Revolution, and settled in many of the same places. Most of them originally started in Pennsylvania. Many of them stayed in Pennsylvania and became the so-called Pennsylvania Dutch, who were actually Germans and people of German descent. Many of them also followed the Scots-Irish down into Virginia and into the Carolinas, into the Piedmont region, and settled in those same places. And we'll talk about one German family after a while as well that kind of followed that trail and ended up in the Ozarks. And many people in the Ozarks today can trace their lineage, at least parts of their branches of their family tree, back to those German settlers of the 1700s. Even though by the time many of them got to the Ozarks, with some exceptions we'll talk about, many of them had anglicized their names, and so that later generations of the family would be surprised to find out that they were German. They had often adopted English, maybe lost their mother tongue, and had been, fully integrated into English-speaking American society by then. So there are lots of Germans as well, Scots-Irish, people of English ancestry. The main thing is, by the time many of these settlers get to the Ozarks, they're mutts. They're not one strain of anything. Some of them have got Indian blood in them. There are thousands of slaves who were brought to the Ozarks. There are some free blacks who come to the Ozarks. It's not really a melting pot in the Ozarks, but there's a lot of different strains of heritage of those Ozark settlers, and many of them were mutts by the time they got here. Many of them were part German, part English, part Scots-Irish, part Indian, and so it's different than some of the, when we talk about the German settlers who come straight from Germany to Missouri beginning in the 1830s, it's a very, very different concept. Here we're talking about people who've been in America for at least a couple generations in most cases before they get to the Ozarks. Later on, when we get to those Missouri Valley Germans, we'll talk about people who are coming straight over and who do not speak English and who maintain their German traditions very stridently for generations. So what you've got is an Upland South amalgam, a group of mutts who come over and have a distinctive lifestyle that's very similar to the lifestyle and the strategy of living that people, that their ancestors and their cousins back in Tennessee and Kentucky and Virginia and the Carolinas have when they get here. And the last part that we're going to talk about in this section is some of the very earliest of the Anglo-American settlers that we have. We talked about Cape Girardeau earlier, and that was one of the earliest destinations for Anglo-American settlers. Why would it make sense that some of the earliest U.S. citizens came across the river and went to Cape Girardeau? Where is Cape Girardeau? It's on the Mississippi.
Not far from the Ohio.
You're right. It's just up the Mississippi from the confluence with the Ohio. And it's about as far east as you can get at the very edge of the Ozarks. And so it's about as close to the east, to the United States. Again, we're talking about the 1700s now, so Missouri soil is Spanish territory, and Cape Girardeau was about as close to the United States as you could get and be at least on the edge of the Ozarks. So it makes sense that those earliest Anglo settlers ended up there. Beginning in the mid-1790s, there was a small colony of Virginians who settled in the Cape Girardeau area. Most of them just west of Cape Girardeau, just up in the hills a little ways from Cape Girardeau, led by the Ramsey family. Now, the timing here is significant because for many years, the Spanish had been very reluctant to invite Anglo-American settlers onto their soil. They didn't really want them here. But there was a change in philosophy in the 1790s, and beginning at least in the mid-1790s, the Spanish government began to actively recruit Anglo-American settlers to come to Louisiana, to come to what we know as Missouri and Arkansas. And there were plenty of Anglo-American settlers who were willing to take them up on it. And how they would do that was that they would offer grants of land, basically free land. You pay a little money to have the paperwork done, transaction fee sort of thing, we might call it, and you get free chunks of land. Now, there were usually stipulations that came with that. Spain was a Catholic nation. The United States in the 1790s, overwhelmingly a Protestant nation. And one of the stipulations that the Spanish had was, okay, Anglo-Americans, we'll give you this land, you can come over here, but you're going to have to be Catholic, or at least you're going to have to raise your children Catholic. That was one of the rules that they had. As you can imagine, since there weren't Spanish officials hiding in every community, making sure that these Anglo-American settlers, practically all of whom were Protestant, didn't have Protestant church services. This was a rule that, for the most part, was ignored by the Anglo settlers. Technically, they were supposed to raise their children Catholic, but most of them continued to practice whatever religion they had practiced before they got here. Sometimes the Spanish required that people who were given a grant of land would have to recruit other families to come with them to increase the population in this Spanish territory. And the idea was you increase the population, you spur commerce, and it generates money. I mean, that's what this is all about. It's generating money, whether it's through farming or mining or fur trading or hunting or whatever it is. You get more people, generate more money, get things rolling a little bit. So the Spanish gave these land grants beginning in the 1790s and continuing all the way up until France took back over the area, and then the Louisiana Purchase happens. So you get several of these land grants that are given out, many of them in the Ozarks, in the eastern part of the Ozarks. The land grants really don't get this far over into the Ozarks, but several places in the eastern Ozarks were given as Spanish land grants. One neat recipient colony that received one of these land grants was the so-called Bollinger Colony. And what's unusual about this group is that they were German speakers. They came from the United States. They came, most of them came from North Carolina, but they were of German descent, and most of them still spoke German at the time that they came to what we know as Cape Girardeau County today. And they were led by George Frederick Bollinger, who was German himself. They were actually Swiss Germans. They were from Switzerland, but they were German-speaking Swiss. And George Frederick Bollinger and some of his other colony members were given land grants on the Whitewater River in what today is Cape Girardeau County. They settled in the area where of the present-day town of Burfordville, a little bitty place over not too far out of. There's a mill, there's a state park, old Burfordville, or the old mill is there. And they settled there. Eventually, this most of the Bollinger colony were Lutherans. They were German Lutherans. And eventually, they spread out and established other little settlements in the eastern part of the Ozarks over into what's now Bollinger County and in other places in that region. The most famous of these land grants, and the last one we'll talk about, was granted to someone that we recognize, even if we maybe don't recognize him just yet, Moses Austin, one of the most famous early Missouri settlers, father of Stephen F. Austin, who's my Texas? You've heard of Stephen F. Austin, yeah. The father of Texas, and Stephen F. Austin was actually partly raised in Missouri. Moses Austin, a little background on Moses Austin. Unlike so many of those early settlers in the Missouri Ozarks, or the Ozarks in general, Moses Austin was from New England. He didn't get a lot of New Englanders in the Ozarks, but he had been born and raised in Connecticut. As a young man, he had gotten into, had gone to work for a Philadelphia business, and that work eventually took him down into Virginia. In the 1790s, he established himself as the premier lead producer in the state of Virginia. He was actually living in that Upland South area that we talked about in western Virginia. And in the 1790s, he began to look around for a place to expand his lead mining and lead smelting operations to, as the lead industry was slumping a little bit in Virginia. And he had heard about all of these old French and Spanish lead mines in Missouri. In 1797, he made his way to Missouri. He almost froze to death coming across Indiana and Illinois. He got to St. Louis and regained his strength, went down into the Ozarks, into what now is Washington County, Missouri, visited some lead mines there and decided, okay, this is the place for me. He petitioned the Spanish officials in St. Louis for a land grant. They gave him roughly 1 league of land. Does anybody know what a league was? A league was roughly it was a square distance that roughly you could walk in an hour's time. What do we usually walk in? What's assumed about 3 miles an hour. So a league was roughly 3 miles by 3 miles, 3 miles square or 9 miles square, 3 by 3 miles. Big piece of land, lots of acres in a league. And he was granted a league by the Spanish government on Britain Creek, or sometimes called Burton Creek, usually not called Breton Creek. You know, we just don't pronounce anything the way it's spelled in the Ozarks. And there was already, as you can see there from the French name, Mine of Britain, there was already lead mining that had been going on there for several years, but he was given this big chunk of lead mining area land. In 1798, he moved his family over, his extended family over, and several other families of workers. He brought slaves with him from Virginia and started mining lead and smelting lead, and within a few years had become the leading lead producer in all of Spanish America, even before it became part of the Louisiana Purchase to the United States. You can see there roughly 9.4 square miles, almost 3 by 3. And Moses Austin would have eventually found the town of Potosi on his land grant that he had. Potosi is still the seat of Washington County today, and it's still, that's the old Austin land grant there. And near the end of his life, a few years after he had founded Potosi, he also founded a town on the Mississippi called Herculaneum. For those of you who are from the St. Louis area, you know, downriver from St. Louis, Herculaneum became a very important port-type town in those days as well. And as his fortunes began to wane a little bit in Missouri, he turned his sights to Texas, and he had actually gone to Texas and had helped arrange for a Spanish, of course, Texas was part of the Spanish Empire as well, and he had helped arrange to get a land grant in Texas that he then was never able to take advantage of because he died before he ever made it back to Texas. But his son, Stephen F. Austin, went, and the rest is Texas history, I guess you could say. But Moses Austin is probably the best known of many of those early Anglo settlers. And there were lots of others who went on to success or had children who went on to success to become governors and senators and stuff like that, who lived in the Eastern Ozarks on those Spanish land grants in those early days, but none of them were better known than Moses Austin. Any questions about our early days of Anglo settlement so far? All right.
I do have.
Butch?
A dumb question. When the German, where did they come? You would say they came to America.
Right.
Where did they land?
The
New Orleans or?
Most of them landed at Philadelphia.
Okay.
Yeah, Philadelphia. The Germans that we're talking about here, most of whom are coming over in the years before the American Revolution, Philadelphia is just like a big beacon for them. We know, going all the way back to the days of William Penn, he actively recruited people from all over Europe to come to his colony. And compared to a lot of the other colonies, Pennsylvania had religious freedom. And so lots of people were attracted to Pennsylvania and Philadelphia especially, and then they kind of just spread out from there.